There is no trick. You just can't be done.
When I used to play a lot of bebop, we would see each other on the street. You go, bebop, you know, somebody, and we knew what we were saying to each other. We didn't need words to talk. Now, Brian is that very same way.
And that was a beautiful bass sound on that D thing. It was just perfect. Julius, that's a real kind of a tough thing to swing into, you know? Here we go, from the top. Sounds groovy.
To promote Pet Sounds, the Beach Boys hired the Beatles publicist, Derek Taylor, who made sure the right people wrote about the music. The rest of the band often resented their portrayal as the unwitting messengers of Brian's genius.
His blessing and his curse is he's a genius. And if I were a genius, I'd hate to have anyone tell me that.
I'm not sure that the genius tag is something that has been a weight around Brian's neck as much as it's been a weight around all of our necks in relation to how we perceive Brian and create what we're creating about Brian.
I mean, he turned his back on his whole world, including his band's world, to create his own vision of music, to give people something that we still have today. So I'm just saying that's not genius, that's just guts.
Most nights, Brian found his muse getting stoned. Before writing lyrics, Asher and Wilson had long conversations about life and love.
Where did your long hair go? Where is the girl I used to know?
He was trying to resolve a lot of issues for himself. You know, a lot of questions about whether he had made a mistake by getting married, because he cared a lot about Marilyn, but also it was terribly attracted to all these other women that he would see.
Who took that look away?
Joy's music has nothing to do with how joyful it was making the music.
And he put his heart and soul into that. Sat up in that bedroom, in that bed, listen to everything, and we're both hysterically crying throughout the whole album. Just crying.
Break my heart, I don't want to go and cry. It's so sad to watch a sweet thing.
And it fades. And I'm speechless. Brian says, "What do you think of it?" And I said, "Brian, that's the most incredible record you've ever made." And Brian says, "What do you think the guys will think of it?"
They didn't like it. Mike said, "Gee, you know, it's too much of a departure." I said, "But Mike, I got to do it this way for just one album." He goes, "All right, one album." I made a deal. We shook hands at one album. And that was Pet Sounds.
Mike Love called it Brian's ego music and found some of the lyrics nauseating.
Because Brian and Mike were always pretty much, you know, having this little dance. You know what I mean?
Mike was the band's front man, but Brian asserted control in the studio. Vocal sessions were strained.
And they didn't know I was even there, and they'd say things like, you know, "I don't know why we're recording these stupid songs anyway," or whatever, you know. And I thought, why am I sitting here listening to that? I don't need to.
And God only knows what I'd be without you.
Pet Sounds made it to a respectable number 10 on the charts, but compared to previous Beach Boys records, it was a disappointment.
What do they say? Happy songs sell records, sad songs sell beer.
Mike, to his credit, understood what the music was not, and what it was not was more of the same.
Capitol Records failed to embrace Brian's new musical direction. 8 weeks after the release of Pet Sounds, they stocked record stores with a greatest hits album. In England, Pet Sounds was hailed as an instant classic. Paul McCartney and John Lennon said the album inspired their work on Sgt. Pepper's Lonely Hearts Club Band. Undeterred by the tepid reaction at home, Brian stepped up his creative energy.
It was just an absolute mind-boggling event and so exciting to be around, and totally generated by this one force. And it was just him just moving by himself doing this.
Even the people that weren't depending on it, he felt they were depending on him, and he would feel that if he failed, everybody else failed.
Brian Wilson's four-year evolution had created a pop music revolution. His next song would be the 24-year-old's crowning achievement and also prove his undoing. In 1966, Ronald Reagan was elected governor of California, animator Walt Disney died of cancer, and Brian Wilson, at the age of 24, was the most popular American songwriter of his generation.
I love the colorful clothes you wear, and the way the sunlight plays upon her hair.
Good Vibrations took 6 months to record, costing $50,000 for 3.5 minutes of pop bliss.
We're saying again, Good Vibrations, people have called a pocket symphony. Is that pop music? Is that rock and roll? What is it?
She's giving me the excitations. I'm backing up. Good Vibrations. She's giving me the excitations.
Brian used hashish and amphetamines on a regular basis. He took to recording Good Vibrations in snippets, which he later pieced together. It became his new approach to songwriting.
Because sometimes we would come in, we would play 4 bars of music, and Brian would say, "Thank you, gentlemen," and that was it. Sometimes we'd work, 4, 5, 6 hours at a time.
Tony Asher had written lyrics to the song, but Brian let a skeptical Mike Love write new ones.
Okay, so here, catch. You can come up with something better. We're doing it tonight. I'll see you there,
It was a scary little record to make, But it's okay now. I went through a lot of bullshit over it, It took me on a ride that I didn't want to go on.
In November 1966, Good Vibrations shot to the top of the charts. The Beach Boys edged out the Beatles in a British popularity poll. But at 24, Brian Wilson had written his last number one hit. The song was to be the first track of the next Beach Boys album, Dumb Angel. Brian described the project as a teenage symphony to God. He later changed its name to Smile.
His life was humor, and of course in those days, humor was like passé. I mean, we were all very serious people, and everything was... acid-tinged seriousness. And here's this guy who thinks that, the essence of everything that is good is humor.
I've been in this town so long and back in the city. I've been taken for lost and gone and unknown for a long, long time.
For a collaborator, Brian chose Van Dyke Parks, a sharp-tongued southerner, once described as Edith Sitwell on Speed.
There was an obsession to reject anything that smacked patriotism. The Beach Boys, pan-patriotic, kind of a trans-presidential vibe, was, to me, an ideal platform to talk about what we knew.
I really hear America. I really feel that he was trying to sum up America. He was literally trying to take Mark Twain into rock and roll. And he almost got there. He almost got there.
Under a drug-induced umbrella, life at the Wilsons' home became unreal. Brian's piano sat in a vast sandbox in the living room.
People just wanted to be around Brian. They wanted to get what he had. You can't get what's in there. He was born with what he had.
He was being accepted as just a creative genius, and so that allows you to sort of indulge yourself, and he did.
One observer called it the Mad Hatter's Tea Party. Nights were filled with speed-induced hunts for ping-pong tables or telescopes. Brian talked about the importance of health and opened a natural food store on the Sunset Strip called the Radiant Radish.
I mean, this fellow who Paul McCartney and Sir George Martin and